John Carter has visited a part of Europe where the wounds of war have eventually healed. He went to Germany, making the 1 hour, 45-minute flight to Berlin.
November 1989, the cry for freedom was finally heard.
When it happened, when the hammers and chisels, the bare hands and the bulldozers tore down this Berlin Wall, did you say, I never thought I'd see the day? But the day came, the wall came down. The killing fields in between have been cleared, and there's talk of turning it into a memorial park. The two Berlins, West and East, like the two Germanys, are now united.
The River Spree was part of the Berlin barrier. People swam across it to escape, and many were shot. Wreaths and crosses mark where they fell. On the same spot, the touts now sell fragments of the wall as souvenirs. Insensitive doesn't begin to describe it. The ruins of the Kaiser Wilhelm Memorial Church, a powerful West Berlin symbol. The stump of the steeple will never be restored, but remains a reminder of the city's wartime suffering. The Reichstag, the parliament building, was also destroyed like so much else in Berlin, but some historic buildings survived, the finest being the Charlottenburg Palace. The famous zoo's been rebuilt and restocked and is one of the sights of the center, a little way from Kurfürstendamm, Berlin's most lively promenade. The Kudamm, they call it. Open-air cafes and bars, street entertainers, beggars and prostitutes, all human life is there. There are shops too, of course, bright lights and baubles that help boost the morale of a once isolated and divided city. There's still evidence of that division, Checkpoint Charlie, through which you drive unhindered into the east to Unter den Linden, where soldiers perform a military minuet at the new guardhouse. Already the sad little Trabants are being swept aside by BMWs and Mercedes. The streets round St. Nicholas Church are the prettiest part of East Berlin. A surprise for me anyway were the beaches of West Berlin, of which the Strandbad Wannsee is the largest. Even when the city was an island surrounded by East Germany, there was no feeling of claustrophobia here. The beaches along the Havel River, the forest acres of Grunwald, gave Berliners space to breathe. It was time to move on from my Berlin hotel. I collected a self-drive car and headed off for an excursion into East Germany, down the main road through the Grunwald towards the old border and the city of Potsdam. Nowadays, it's just like driving from London to Windsor, but once this bridge was a barrier, the ill-named Unity Bridge. You've seen it on the news. It's where they used to swap spies. Potsdam's pride is the palace and gardens of Sanssouci, the home of Frederick the Great. He wanted somewhere simple where he could pursue his passion for philosophy in the company of Voltaire in the 1750s. Next day, I took the motorway through the border post at Dreilinden past the Soviet war memorials. A few hundred yards later was the traffic control point at Drewitz. Like all the other checkpoints, its huge expanse is abandoned and no longer a barrier. It's become a different kind of memorial to a different kind of war. Beyond it, the Autobahn into East Germany. Dresden. During this visit to East Germany, I didn't plan to dwell too much on the events of the Second World War. After all, what's happening here now and what the future holds is of greater relevance than the past. But wartime history can't be ignored. Not in Dresden.
On February the 13th, 1945, this Florence of the North was reduced to rubble and ashes.
The work of restoration's by no means over, but enough's been done for visitors to see and admire, and those visitors are increasingly arriving from the West. The sightseeing circuit takes them, as it should certainly take you, to the Zwinger, Dresden's main tourist attraction, originally built in the early 18th century, heavily rebuilt in the late 20th. Of the museums, the Green Vault in the Albertinum building houses one of Europe's most dazzling treasuries. Dresden has its modern side, parts that were rebuilt in Soviet 60s style, pedestrian precincts and wide streets for trolleybuses and trabants. Located near the old heart of the city is Dresden's top hotel, the Dresdner Hof, opened less than a year ago. The Bellevue is on the other bank of the River Elbe. Regular boat services are one way of getting to see nearby sites. A short distance to the southeast of Dresden, upstream, is Pillnitz and its palaces. This was the country seat of Augustus the Strong, with gardens as attractive as the buildings. Farther upstream still is the region known as Saxon Switzerland. Rocky bastions towering above the river give you a terrific view of the valley and the surrounding countryside and provide a challenge for those who can't resist one. On a lower level, I decided to take myself and the hire car for a trip through gentler countryside to see the castle at Moritzburg. Very impressive. Moritzburg's in the middle of a forest region with large lakes round it. It's a quiet area, though obviously the castle attracts many visitors. Actually, it isn't strictly speaking a castle. It started life as a hunting lodge for those Saxon electors. Its builder, Poppelmann, was responsible for the Zwinger in Dresden and that summer palace at Pillnitz too. So he proved to be quite an asset as far as today's tourist industry is concerned.
The East Germans look on tourism as an industry without factories, something to provide jobs and foreign currency, both of which they desperately need. As a destination, it's got a lot of rough edges. It's for travellers rather than tourists, but already the coaches are thundering down the autobahns, the sightseeing groups are being shepherded around the cities. It's opening up for tourism. Speaking personally, it's the rough edges that make it interesting.